So I think since we had the tsunami, so let's discuss a bit of that, some of the physics connected to that, you know, it's really weird. Because we heard its magnitude 8.9 on the Richter scale. And so what energy release does it correspond to? You know, all these Richter scales are logarithmic, like most other things in physics. Like magnitude of the stars, that's all the logarithmic. And you know, the sound intensity, they are in decibels, that's also logarithmic. Wind speeds are also logarithmic. Beaufort scale, they call it. So here also, Richter and Gutenberg introduced the logarithmic scale to quantify earthquakes. So the formula they generally use is for suppose you know an earthquake of Richter 8.9 or 8 or whatever, or 6 or whatever. What is the energy released? How would they estimate the energy released? So I'll just give you the formula they use normally. So this log 10 E in joules, this is in joules. Okay. So this is given by, this is just a coincidence, we have a similar thing in for Luminosity scales for stars. This is, you know, 2.5 log and 2 by 1. So here 2.5 m, m is a magnitude, this is a magnitude, and they put a minus 1. So now we can estimate, suppose it is this in joules, that's why J. So you can calculate now with this 8.9, almost 9. So it works out about, so about 21 minus 1, about 20, 10 to the 20 joules. So roughly the energy released, okay. So this works out about, if you take the typical 1 megaton nuclear weapon, this works out the intensity of about 50,000 nuclear bombs. Okay. So 100 megaton, which is the most powerful nuclear weapon tested so far by Russia. Russia once tested a 60 megaton nuclear thing. So that's about 5 × 10^24 bombs. Okay. 100 megatons. So this is equivalent to something like about 30,000 or 40,000. Critical nuclear weapons, okay. 1 megaton. Okay. So that's why you might have seen reports that it's equal to, you know, several tens of thousands of nuclear weapons. So this is how they estimate 10 to 20 joules. So something on Richter 7 will be about 10 times weaker, okay. Or 100 times weaker. Okay. So the most powerful earthquake record are of this order, 8.9 or 9. Okay. And this also, of course, triggered a tsunami. And for that, you know, you need a little more of a little more information. So what's happening is these underground earthquakes normally it comes about because the tectonic plates, but tectonic plates subducts, you know, it goes down another tectonic plate. So the actually in between is pushed up. Okay. And so it so happens only on Earth they have straight tectonics. That's because it doesn't happen in any other planet. Venus doesn't have plate tectonics, Mars doesn't have. So there's an essential condition for this, that there should be a lot of water on the planet, you know. This water goes deep inside. In fact, these phenomena affect only the crust and the mantle, upper part of the mantle. Okay. So you know the Earth is divided into 7 layers. So you've got the outer crust. Okay. The lithosphere. Lithosphere is the crust and the mantle. The upper mantle goes down to about 20 kilometers. So most of the earthquakes are, you know, the origin is about 10 kilometers deep or 20 kilometers deep. Okay. Not very much deeper than that. So it's essentially, as far as the diameter of the earth is concerned, these are all basically surface phenomena. So what's happening is, because of the presence of the water, we have got all this molten rock. Okay. Because there's increase of pressure with depth. Okay, and temperature also. Okay. So we go a few kilometers down, the temperature gradient is there. So the rock becomes quite molten. Okay. And originally these things became molten because of the radioactivity in the crust. Okay. A lot of isotopes, 40 calcium, so many 40 potassium, so many isotopes are there. So these usually provided much of the heat to keep the earth hot. Okay. So what has happened is the rocks get molten and therefore it forms what's called magma. Okay. Not plasma, magma. Nothing but you know molten or semi-molten rock.
Okay.
So it's highly viscoelastic fluid.
Okay.
It is both viscous and elastic.
Okay.
And you can move. So the continents are literally floating on these. The continents are nothing but continent plates floating on these in this manner.
Okay.
So every continent has got a plate, even other land masses have got their own plates. India has got its own plate, the Indian plate.
Okay.
And the Asia has got the Asian, China has got its own plate. So apparently the India was at one time near the Atlantic.
Okay.
About 200 million years ago, India was very much in the southern hemisphere. Then the Indian plate broke up. So initially there was only one huge, two huge continents, Laurasia and Gondwana.
Okay.
And even before that there was only one supercontinent, Pangaea. All the land masses were, you know, in one piece.
Okay.
And it was Alfred Wegener who suggested that all the continents were part of one land mass. Because he noticed that the jigsaw puzzle, the west coast of Africa fits nicely in the east coast of South America. And similarly, you could fit in Australia and India,
okay,
and Africa. And so all this, like a jigsaw puzzle, you could fit all that into one piece. So he suggested the continental altitude drifting, but nobody believed in that time. But then now it has become a reality with GPS and other things, because they actually have to measure the small drifting continents.
Okay.
In fact, Indian plate is still going onwards. They are pushing against China. And so what's happening is the Himalayas are growing taller. And the Himalayas are the result of the Indian plate colliding with the Asian plate,
okay,
about 40 million years ago. So Himalayas are quite young mountains, okay, they formed only 40 million years ago.
Okay.
And as evidence of this, we see even fossils of marine animals on top of a mountain list.
Okay.
This was the one part, one time it was all part of the sea. So all this mountain building and movement of continents are all connected.
Okay.
So the Earth's surface is in a state of flux, okay, continuous flux. So all the continents are moving around. So even now the Mediterranean is closing because the African plate is pushing northwards again.
Okay.
And similarly, Europe is again trying to merge with America, so the Atlantic is shrinking.
Okay.
So in another 100 million years, maybe sometime I will talk about it. People have actually estimated what will happen after 100 million years. The face of the continent will be very different.
Okay.
So you see, after all, humanity has been there only for a few, when we started doing science and technology on a vast scale, we are hardly a few centuries in existence, as far as these things are concerned. But these things have been going on for several millions of years, or hundreds of millions of years. So luckily the result of all these several continental plates are there. The American plate is there, South America has got one plate, Africa has got one plate, Australia has got one plate, they're all drifting. And especially around the Pacific, there's a highly all these plates are sort of merging.
Okay.
But at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. So it's the biggest ocean right now.
Okay,
but maybe it won't be the biggest ocean after say 100 million years. So actually there's a ring of fire around Japan and all these islands in the Pacific. So that's why these are highly earthquake prone regions, because these plates every now and then they collide.
Okay.
And the intensity of the collision depends on how much matter is thrust up and so on.
Okay.
So we can, in fact, in 2004 there was another big underground earthquake in Indonesia that led to again a big tsunami which caused 2 lakh people to die. Including several in the Sri Lanka coast and in Chennai also.
Okay.
A lot of people died.
Okay.
So again, that happened around hardly 7 years back, 2004, 6 years back.
Okay.
And even last year was Chile, 2010 there was a big earthquake, 18, and Chile there was a very big tsunami. So, the past year there have been 3 or 4 cities.